Hey everyone, it's Ventus. Recently there was an update on PvE, and it looks like we've got more unique content coming our way. This time it's a new featured game mode, and this is a game mode that I really, really, really like. We've gone through many featured game modes already. We've gone through All for One, Showdown, Hexakill, Doombots, Urf, and several variations of some of them, but none of them have been really strategically stimulating. Doombots and Urf were obviously really fun, but the other game modes, well, not so much. They weren't very great, both in terms of fun and strategy. And this brings me to Black Market Brawlers, the Bilgewater-themed featured game mode. In this game mode, you play 5v5 on Summoner's Rift as usual, except there are several key gameplay differences. The first one is, you can hire mercenaries to replace your minions. Now, these mercenaries, you don't hire them with gold, but you hire them with a new currency called Krakens. Krakens are obtained passively over time, but you can actively get them too. You can get them through kills and assists, and also through objective control and counter jungling, which opens up a wide variety of ways to actually get these Krakens and upgrade your mercenaries. There are four types of these mercenaries. They're called Brawlers, each of them with their own strengths and weaknesses. So basically, you have to choose correctly. Once you hire one kind of mercenary, you can upgrade their ability, attack, or health, but once this mercenary is locked in, you can't hire any other type. This means you'll have to hire the mercenary that works well with your team and works well against the enemy team. Additionally, you need to upgrade them intelligently as well, although I did find that upgrading their abilities first is generally a pretty good idea. If you're playing this game mode with a bunch of friends in a pre-made party, then you can coordinate your tactics with them. Which mercenary do you want? Do you want to stack one kind of mercenary? Do you want a balanced team? Do you want to focus on offense or defense? Basically, all of these factors combined makes it so that this game mode has a really high degree of strategy involved. Now, that's not all there is to this game mode. You don't just hire mercenaries and just play 5v5. I guess it'd be pretty fun still, but it wouldn't be that much more fun than the other game modes. So that brings me to the second part of Black Market Brawlers, and that is, well, not the brawler portion, but the black market portion. Along with the standard items you can get on Summoner's Rift, there's a new tab in your shop full of very interesting and unique items, some of which have mechanics that have never been seen before in League of Legends. Let's first get into game and check out the brawlers and items before I get into a more detailed analysis of the content, how to play it, and what this means, or what this could mean, for the future of League of Legends. It's all pretty exciting stuff. Alright then, so we're in game now. So you see the tips on the side, higher brawlers with Krakens, and use the black market. So let's go over the first tab here. So as you see, there are four tabs. Recommended tab is still here, the items are still here, but now you have brawlers and black market. So let's first look at the ability upgrades.
You've landed on Summoner's Rift.
The new pirate announcer. He gets old really fast. He was pretty cool at first, but after playing for a while, he gets old pretty fast. But before looking at any details, so basically you can see your Krakens are up here, and or down here as well, and these cost 5 Krakens each. So when you upgrade, when you want to buy the mercenary, you have to first get 5 Krakens before you do so, and once you buy,
until minions spawn.
Yes, I get it. Once you buy the mercenaries, these will open up for you. Now, the way these upgrades work is the first one costs 5, the second one costs 10, and the third one costs 20. But the amount of increase is, well, it's increased accordingly to the amount of Krakens you spend. So it's actually really, really worth it if you upgrade it fully. You guys gonna talk again.
Here come the minions.
Yeah, okay. It's pretty cool. The announcer's pretty cool. It's just, when you play this game mode for quite a while, that guy gets really old. Some of the kill announcements are really cool, though. Kills, deaths, and whatever. But when you actually play the game, you'll see. Alright, so, let's go over the actual mercenaries then, and their abilities, which is the major thing. The offense and defense upgrades, those are the same for every single mercenary. It's just 10 attack, 20 attack, 30 attack, up to 60, and then 100 HP, 200 HP, and you Guessed it, 300 HP, up to 600. Alright, so the first mercenary, the first brawler that you get is the Melee Champion Pursuer, the Razor Fit. So these things are just giant rats. It's kind of gross. They're these huge giant rats. And what they do is they're basically the unit that kind of zergs the enemy. So as you can see from the description, it chases down enemy champions relentlessly and they deal bonus damage and they can also grow in number. So looking at the upgrades, the ability upgrades, this is where you can actually see what happens when you upgrade these mercenaries. So starting with the Razor Fin, upon aggroing an enemy champion, your Razor Fin will pursue them endlessly. While attacking enemy champions, your Razor Fin has 100% increased movement speed and ignores unit collision. So that's pretty cool. That's the level 1 upgrade. Ah, I'm here. Okay, so the level 2 upgrade is each time your Razor Fin hits an enemy champion and applies a mark, on the third mark, the Razor Fin deals 300% damage to the target. It's pretty crazy, pretty good damage. But a lot of the upgrades, they get really insane after you get level 2, level 3. Like I said earlier, basically, the ability upgrades seem to be the best ones, but some of their abilities have better scaling with these stats as well, so you really have to upgrade it accordingly. Third one, okay, let's go. Razor Fin will now spawn two of them. There's going to be two Razor Fins instead of one, so you're going to have two Razor Fins per wave, and each of them that are going to pursue the enemy champions whenever they aggro, and they're going to deal bonus damage and chase them for basically forever if they can survive long enough. If they don't die to the tower, they'll just chase them forever no matter what. I know that some people get really annoyed when, let's say, the minions follow you through the jungle like this. But these things follow you through the jungle like crazy, as long as they have vision of you. They drop aggro when they don't have vision, but as long as they have vision of you, they will chase you much faster than you can run away most of the time, and it's really annoying. So, to go over what the giant rats are good for, I found them really good against champions like Ziggs and Xerath. Poke champions, basically. So these champions, they like to auto-attack enemy champions, they like to poke from a distance, and at the earlier levels, their cooldowns are kind of long, and they don't really have a way to deal with things kind of jumping on top of them. They don't have any dashes, really. Ziggs can kind of knock them back, and Xerath can stun them, but using your cooldowns like that kind of puts you at a disadvantage in lane. So, like, even other champions, not just those two. But basically, these things, because they're so annoying, because they just keep on chasing you the moment they aggro you, let's say you just want to harass the enemy champion. Well, now if you do that, you're going to have some giant rats on you, and that's quite annoying for these kinds of long-range poke champions. When you fully upgrade the Razor Fins, obviously two of them are going to spawn, right? So if you're against the poke team, and the poke team doesn't really have a way to deal with these Razor Fins, then you're going to find that they're really going to hate these brawlers. You're going to have, let's say two team members hire mercenaries. So basically, for each person on the team, you can hire one set of mercenaries, and two out of the five people hired the Razor Fins. That means once fully upgraded, once they both reach level 3 abilities, you're going to have four Razor Fins from two people. That means if everybody on your team hires a Razor Fin, you can have 10 of these things swarming the enemy. So if you want to go all in on just having these melee minions, then that could be a way to go. It's even more annoying that I found if you upgrade their abilities and then you upgrade their HP. Because these kind of pokey champions, they don't really have a way to kill it fast unless they use their abilities, because their auto attacks are pretty garbage. Their auto attacks won't kill these things fast enough. If you continuously give them more HP rather than just focusing on their attack to make them do more damage, well, they're going to stick on you longer, and that's going to make them do more damage. And in that sense, they're actually better with a few defensive stats. But offensive stats work too. So those are the Razor Fins, the really annoying melee champion pursuing rats. I like to choose this when I have a team comp that can cover them. So let's say you have a team comp with shields that can shield minions. If you shield the Razor Fins and they pursue enemy poke champions, you're just gonna ruin their day basically. And especially if you have some kind of speed up to speed up your minions, maybe have a Sivir as your AD carry, something like that, then these things will be even faster. And because they ignore unit collision, they're gonna get to their target very easily, and you can just Zerg them to death. It's basically like a Zerg tactic to use the Razor Fins. All right, so the next one is the Ironbacks. So these are giant turtles. These giant turtles are melee minions. They're about as strong as melee minions. That's kind of the confusing thing. It's kind of hard to last hit these because you don't know how strong they are, especially when you upgrade their health. It becomes kind of ambiguous. But these ones, they're melee minions that are not quite as tanky as siege minions, not quite as tanky as the cannon minions, but they're still pretty tanky. So let's see what they do. Ironbacks can take reduced damage from minions and gain a shield that blocks attacks as they're upgraded. They can also deal extra damage to structures, and all Ironbacks take 25% reduced damage from enemy turrets. Okay. So they're basically used to siege, if that wasn't obvious enough. Their level 1 ability. Your Ironback deals 175% damage to enemy structures. Your Ironback gains a shield that blocks the attack damage from the next basic attack from a champion or a turret. On-hit effects like Lichbane are not blocked. The shield is renewed every 10 seconds after it breaks. So you have a renewable shield that can block tower shots, which can be pretty annoying, and it can also block auto attacks. So AD carries probably get most of their damage, a lot of the damage mitigated from their offensive attacks, because AD carries auto attacks, that's the main part of their damage. And if you remove one entirely, then that's quite annoying for them. So these things, in a siege scenario, they're really good, and they're also decently good against AD carries. Now, level 2 Ironback, your Ironback deals 250% damage to enemy structures, and while your Ironback's shield is active, it also takes 35% reduced damage from minions. So when you're doing like a slow push in the side lane, or like let's say there's no champions in that lane, or like the first tower here is dead. Oh, it's about to be dead anyway because for some reason they're both pretty unhealthy. I guess this one's gonna die first though. But let's say that there's no tower here. The tower here is gonna get destroyed, and you have a bunch
Turret
of
destroyed! Your turret's been destroyed!
I get it. Okay, so you have a bunch of these Ironbacks coming through here, and there's no champion in the lane. So, and there's no champion, there's no turret in the lane. That means that they're gonna be as tanky as a siege minion, basically. They're gonna take reduced damage from minions, all minions. So they're just gonna like push up your lane very quickly. So if you like pushing up lanes, if you like split pushing, even if you like slow pushing, some tactical pushing, applying map pressure on the other side of the map that your team is not at, then these are the minions for you because of that amazing shield they get and because of the reduced damage they take. Now, level 3 is when it gets really crazy. Your Ironback deals 325% damage to enemy structures. The shield cooldown is reduced to 3 seconds. And while active, it takes 60% reduced damage from minions. So it's basically like a full-on upgrade. It's not like the Razor Fin where you just double the amount of Razor Fins. It's a full-on upgrade of the previous stats. It's absolutely insane. The shield goes from 10 seconds to 3 seconds, and the damage increase goes to 325%, and the damage reduction goes to 60%. So these things are the ultimate siegers. If you're against a team without any wave clear, without a way to remove all of these from the minion wave, they're not gonna have a good time. So Razor Fins, they're good against these kind of wave clear champions, long range poke champions like Ziggs and Xerath, but the Ironbacks are not that good against them. The Ironbacks will actually take a lot of damage from them, mainly because they block auto attacks. They don't block spells, and basically, the way it works is once you remove these, the wave will not be as strong as it used to be. Once you remove the shield, once they don't have the damage reduction, And once they don't hit the tower anymore, then they're gonna be doing a lot less than before. They're gonna be a lot weaker than before. So pick these when you're against AD comps, champions that like to auto attack a lot, AD carries, and things without wave clear. So if you're against, let's say, a Zed. Zed's wave clear is all right, but he focuses a lot of on auto attacks, and he really needs to just, hit things to actually do damage to them. Well, if you have a lot of these, you mitigate a lot of his damage. If let's say he's split pushing, and you have these on in one of the side lanes that he's split pushing. Well, he's going to split push a lot slower because the shield is going to block a lot of the damage. He's not just going to sit there and wait for his cooldowns to use spells. He's going to be auto attacking. So because he's going to be auto attacking, he's going to be dealing a lot less damage overall. His DPS will go a lot lower because basically these guys have a Pantheon
You're
shield.
out a turret.
Basically, they have like a Pantheon passive to some extent. So if you want to siege a lot, if you want to split push a lot, if you want to like play a tactical game, this is probably the minion of your choice. Similar to the Razorfin, I found
Your
it.
turret in splinters.
Wow, the enemy team is destroying me. Like the Razorfins, I like to upgrade defense on these first because they are a defensive unit. I found that because they're melee, it's better to upgrade them their HP rather than their offense because I think they do a decent amount of damage anyway. And once you reach the late game, especially if you're like a carry type champion who gets a lot of kills and assists, the Krakens, the way they work is you get a lot more if you're killing people, getting assists and taking objectives. So if you're a carry champion or if
Turret
you're
destroyed.
Let's just mute that. Like this. Alright. So if you like to if you like to siege a lot, then these are the champions for you, basically. That's basically it. Now let's get to the ranged ones. So you have the Plunder Crab here, the third brawler that you can hire, and these are probably one of the most annoying minions in the game by far. Seriously. But that's from someone who likes to play a lot of melee champions. A lot of the supports I play are kind of low range or melee. A lot of the mid laners that I play, I do play a lot of poke mid laners, but I like the kind of low range mid laners as well. And these champions just make your day a living hell. I mean, these minions just make your day a living hell. So what does the Plunder Crab do? Champion harass. Ranged champion harass. Plunder Crabs shoot additional cannonballs at nearby champions and gain extra range as they're upgraded. They also shoot faster when locking onto enemy champions and deal bonus damage. That's really annoying. All Plunder Crabs have a split shot at plus 150 attack range, but 50% less damage. Alright, so the first ability is Plunder Crabs have 50 more range and gain a stacking 20% attack speed bonus up to 150% for 3 seconds every time they hit a champion. The way they work is, let's say that this is the Plunder Crab. If you walk within its range, let's say like the Meep is the let's say the Bard's Meep is the minion, and they're fighting each other, like two range attackers fighting each other. But the splash range is not quite that far. So let's say if I walk up here, and the Plunder Crab is here, he starts spraying out these little bullets onto you. Which is really annoying. Just because you're in range, it starts spraying onto you, the attacks. And it's also hitting your meep, or your minions, I should say. So, for low-range champions, this is really annoying. The other ones, like the Razorfin's good against these long-range champions who don't really have options in the melee area, like close range. These ones, you need long-range champions to remove them. You have to use long-range champions to remove them. Even champions like Annie, once you have this fully upgraded, I'll get to that in a sec, I guess. So, as you level it up, it gets more attack range. Like, level 2 is 100 more range, and deals 150% damage when hitting enemy champions. And number 3 is it has plus 150 range, and then the on-hit bonus now applies when hitting enemy minions, and it now shoots additional cannonballs at all nearby champions. So, when you reach this point, no one is safe unless they have like this much range. So if you're within their attack range, they're probably gonna start spraying you with cannonballs, and it actually hurts. It really actually hurts. These minions are really, really annoying for low range champions. Basically, anyone who doesn't have at least 700 to 900 range, it's probably gonna get sprayed by it. So when I was playing, like a melee champion like Gangplank, and the enemy team hired like three people hired these Plunder Crabs. So there would be like three Plunder Crabs in the back line. Well, they have a front line of minions, and they also have a back line of Plunder Crabs. So if I try to last hit any minions at all, even the front line, then I just take a ton of damage. My HP bar would just drop like this, gradually drop just like that, just because I'm trying to push the minion wave. And that's what these minions are really strong against. They're really strong against melee champions especially, and lower range champions like Annie. When you go in for a Q, it's gonna hit you, it's gonna splash you, and it's gonna be dealing bonus damage to you, it's gonna be getting more attack speed, and it's gonna start hitting you for chunks of your HP just because you're in range of it. These champions, because they're ranged, they're actually pretty squishy. They die really fast, so you could actually invest in health to make them a little tankier, kind of deceptively tanky, but I like to upgrade their offense because they're ranged, because they get a lot of free attacks, and because if their offense is much higher, they'll be pushing waves much higher. So I found that they work really well with the Ironbacks. You have a tanky front line that's really difficult to kill, and you have these annoying things that spray cannonballs at you from the back. So what are you gonna do? Are you gonna walk up to the Plunder Crab and try and kill it? Or are you gonna kill the Ironbacks who are tanking all of your minion aggro and not taking much damage at all? So essentially, what's gonna happen is you're gonna have a wave that you have a lot of trouble removing just because these two things are in the wave. So like I mentioned before, the tactics, whichever one you want to pick, it's up to you, up to it's based on your team comp, based on how strong they synergize with your team comp and how well they do against the enemy team comp. But this combo I found was really nice. And it's something that you should consider because it kind of covers your bases. You got these things that are decently well against auto attackers, and you got these things that basically if you're melee and you auto attack, you're gonna get killed. And once you combo the two together, it's just gonna be a nightmare for low range champions. And that's the Plunder Crab. That's the this is probably the highest DPS unit. Maybe the Razorfin, once you reach the max upgrade, is the highest DPS. But I found that the Plunder Crabs were the most annoying from my experience. But that's based on my champion pool. All right, so the last one is the Occlpod. Now, I had a problem with these two brawlers, because if you're familiar with the Zelda series, there are these little octopus things called Octoroks, and they kind of look like the Plunder Crab, where they shoot cannonballs at you from their nose or mouth or whatever it is. And this is like a floating octopus thingy. So I kind of got these confused over and over again at the very beginning. But now I know what they are now. Plunder Crab and Occlpod. This thing is the support unit. It's the ranged support unit. And what it does is it casts magic shields on allied minions, gains magic resist as they're upgraded, and it also provides vision in the jungle. These little kind of will-o-wisp thingies that float into the jungle and provide you with vision for a short period of time. And as you can see here, they cast their magic shield on allies every 10 seconds, blocking damage based on their AD. So we kind of see a pattern here, at least with my preferences. All right. So talking about the shield then, let's first talk about the shield. I mentioned that these melee brawlers, I like to upgrade their defense, but for the ranged ones, I like to upgrade their offense just because they're ranged, they're going to be able to deal more DPS. And for this one, it's even a little bit different. Not only are you increasing its damage, but you're also increasing the amount that you shield. And that's really, really nice. So let's look at the Occlpod's abilities. Your Occlpod has 10 magic resist, and they spawn a moving clairvoyance every 30 seconds. After a 4 second delay, it grants vision to a nearby area for 4 seconds. So this is the very first upgrade, and this is probably the worst initial upgrade, I would say, of all of them. Just because Vision is nice, sure, but it doesn't provide you with anything that helps your minion wave. Not particularly, anyway. The magic resist, it's only 10 magic resist. It helps a little bit, but it's still not that great. And you're still going to be relying on its base shield. The base ability of the Aquapod is still really good. Actually, the base ability of the Aquapod can be better than the other ones, but unlike the other three minions, this one is actually really situational. So because it provides a magic shield, you're going to have to use it against a lot of magic damage, champions who deal magic damage. Like the long-range poking champions, you might want to have one of these. If you have a Razorfin with an Aquapod, that is extremely annoying for those long-range poke champions because the Razorfins are going to get shielded by the Aquapod, and it's going to make it even harder for them to die. Abilities will be blocked by the magic shield, and auto attacks don't do much damage. Plus, these things are chasing you forever, so you basically need to be under tower to get them killed. You have to sit under the tower to actually get them killed, and that's not really optimal. If you're laning like in mid lane, let's assume that the towers are still up, and the minions crash in the middle. So if for some reason the enemy Xerath auto attacks you and the Razorfin starts attacking them, the Razorfin has a shield and pushes Xerath back, Xerath will be out of experience range. You're basically going to zone them by not even doing anything at all. If the Xerath attempts to aggro onto you, you can zone them by not doing anything, and it's free zoning. They're going to have to run over here and then get those giant rats killed. Otherwise, the rats will just chase them for a really long time and be almost impossible for them to kill. So those are the situations. That's one of the situations, I should say, that the Aquapod is very useful. Now, second ability, your Aquapod has 20 magic resist, so it gains another 10, and now the shield gets increased by a little bit more. It's pretty good. But like overall, it's still like the same thing. It's still basically the support unit that needs other units to be stronger to actually work well. Because of that, it's something that you have to combo with the other brawlers really well. And I found, like I said, I found it to be best with the Razorfins, but you can also make it work with the Plunder Crab as well. But the Plunder Crabs, the long range champions like Xerath, I'm just going to keep using Xerath as an example, they actually do pretty well against the Plunder Crabs because they don't get in range, they don't get sprayed by the cannonballs, and if you put a shield on it, then it's going to synergize better. Alright, so the last one, third upgrade for the Aquapod is it has 30 magic resist, and their base shield is increased to 300. So this one's 150, I believe. Yeah. So 150 up to 300 now. And now the Clairvoyance casts every 10 seconds instead of every 30 seconds. So you're going to be getting a lot more vision just because you have this in your minion wave. The way it works is, let's say that it's right here, right? It's going to shoot off a little circle that goes through the jungle like this, and then it disappears after a few seconds. So as it keeps going, let's say like 10 seconds it'll be here, and it's going to shoot off another one there. So if, let's say the game does look like this, both of these towers are dead. This is like a danger zone. This entire area is a danger zone. You're going to be getting vision, immediate vision on the side area of your lanes, of both sides of the lanes. So you're going to be providing basically a lot more vision for your team overall without even having to buy wards. And this is why it's so powerful once you upgrade. Like all the level 3 upgrades are really nice. Like I said, the first upgrade for this one, the Aquapod, is not as good as the other ones. But the level 3 one is definitely really good, just like the other ones. The level 3 upgrade for the Aquapod is insanely good because of the utility you get from it. So basically, that's it for the minions. This one, chasing down Xerath. This one is good against auto attackers, good for sieging. This one is good against melee champions. Melee champions hate this thing to death because you just die to it. And this one is a support unit that makes everything else better. So now that we've gone over the minions briefly and went over a little bit of their tactics and synergy, let's hire them and hire one of them and see what it looks like. So right now my lanes are pushing really hard. I don't want to take the inhibitor because it's probably gonna end the game and I still have to go to the black market section. I may have to remake the game for that. But let's hire something that doesn't do too well against the minion wave. So let's just hire the Aqua Pod. All right, so we're gonna have to wait until next wave. So gotta wait a couple seconds. And since I have more brawl, more Krakens, upgrade the ability. A little more. Eight Krakens left. I can't do this anymore. I'm just gonna leave this, so it doesn't really push the wave as hard. We're gonna have a level 2 Aqua Pod in a couple seconds. As you'll see, there we go. There's the Aqua Pod. And you can see this is yours, the one that you hired. Every person gets an Aqua Pod. Every player gets not an Aqua Pod, a mercenary, a brawler to use. And there's the magic shield. Just following this thing around. So basically, once everyone starts getting these brawlers, your minion wave will be replaced. Instead of having the regular minions, the regular melee minions, oh, there's the clairvoyance. Let's see, it's moving around. You're gonna have these things replacing it. So the razor fins, you're gonna have two of them instead of one of these. Aquapods is just one. Plunder crabs just one, and the ironbacks just one. But you're gonna have these really huge minion waves, really powerful minion waves that are much stronger than regular minion waves, and that can be pretty annoying for champions without wave clear. Like overall, because of how strong everything is, wave clear is very important in this game mode, because not just because you want to like push the waves harder, but because you need to shove their waves back. Their waves are going to be just as strong as yours, if not stronger, depending on the composition that they choose. So you're going to need that wave clear to actually do really well in this game mode. And the inhibitor's dead. So actually, I'm going to remake this game. So just give me a second, and I'll remake this game. All right, so we're back in game again. The inhibitor is alive again, so we don't have to worry about it pushing down the Nexus. And let's talk about the black market. We just went over the brawlers. And this time we're going to be talking about the black market. So these are unique items, very interesting items, items that you will only see in this game mode for the time being. Now let's start with top of the list. We're going to go down from physical, magical, defense to utility. And the first one on the list is the Typhoon Claws. So the Typhoon Claws is an AD attack speed item that gives you a little bit of movement speed as well. Builds from pickaxe and a dagger, and it costs 2k altogether. The unique passive is Phantom Hit, the same unique passive as Sated Devourer, which I'll talk about in a second. Basic attacks grant malice charges upon hitting an enemy, and after 3 stacks, your next 3 attacks will be at max attack speed, 2.5 attack speed, and deal 50% less damage. The charges expire after 3 seconds. So basically, this item is an item that wants an item that wants you to attack really fast. It's an item that encourages you to attack really fast and not exactly take advantage of your attack damage, but to apply on-hit effects and other kind of stacking effects. So it's kind of like Sated Devourer in that sense. And that's what gets me to the passive portion of it. Because Typhoon Claws and Sated Devourer shares a unique passive, they can't be bought at the same time. The way the game works with unique passives is that if they have the same name, then they don't stack, which means one will be the one that's used over the other. And because of that, you don't get any synergy between the two, even though the two of them together could have really crazy synergy. You have max attack speed, and you'd be applying these crazy on-hit effects really quickly, and every other hit you'd be applying too with that attack speed. Unfortunately, it's not to be. It's not something that would be very nice, I think. It would make attack speed champions that do on-hit damage a bit too strong. And that's basically one of the reasons why these two share the same unique passive. So this is an item that you will not be seeing in the jungle. This is an item that you will be seeing in the lane. So champions that like to auto-attack a lot, either dealing on-hit damage or applying stacks. So let's say Teemo, Kayle, these are champions that apply on-hit effects. And you also have champions like Vayne and Twisted Fate. These are champions that attack fast, and after a certain number of attacks, onto the target, they deal damage to that target. Typhoon Claws basically makes those champions stronger. Because you'll be dealing less damage per auto attack, you don't want to rely on your AD to deal damage, because the damage will get reduced, and even though you will be dealing a lot of damage, it's still reduced damage, and overall the on-hit effects generally are a little bit better for this item. Now that's not to say it's not going to be a good item for champions with AD, you can still buy it. This item is essentially Jace's hypercharge in his range form, so obviously Jace is AD and he can still make use of this, this kind of effect. So if you just want the attack speed really badly, this can be an item, but you have to keep in mind that it's a kind of low-end item, and even though you do scale pretty well with items, other items, it's going to be an item that you buy early on to kind of snowball with, I believe. That's generally how I've been seeing it and using it. It's a pretty good item, like everything else. Like everything else in the black market, it's a pretty good item. But it's an item that you'd want for certain picks only. If you really did want to build an attack speed item, I don't think it would replace something like a Phantom Dancer. Phantom Dancer is still one of the strongest attack speed items in the game, especially if you're synergizing it with Infinity Edge and other AD items, basically. So in most cases, you probably wouldn't be getting this in AD carries, unless you really just want that stacking effect. That's why you'd be buying it. And that's the Typhoon Claws. Next item is the Flesh Eater, and it's for melee only. The Flesh Eater costs 1460 and gives 20 AD and 10 attack speed, 10 lifesteal, not attack speed. And it builds from a Vamp Scepter and a Longsword. So the Flesh Eater is, I wouldn't say it's one of the most interesting items, but it's definitely one of the stronger items. If you're familiar with the old Bloodthirster, this is kind of like the same item, except the old Bloodthirster stacks up to 100 AD from 60 AD, I believe, and the newer version of the Bloodthirster was like 70 AD, and it stacked up to 100, but obviously that was removed from the game because the current version of the Bloodthirster is the shield version, so it's not the same item anymore. But this is like the Bloodthirster. This is what the Bloodthirster used to be, except the stats are kind of scaled down a little, or a lot, I should say. Quite a lot, actually. But there are reasons for this, so let's talk about the reasons. Passive. Basic attacks build flesh charges. After 5 basic attacks, the Flesh Eater will be ready, allowing you to use Flesh Eater, which rips the flesh from target enemy minion, dealing a bunch of true damage based on your AD, plus a flat amount, and also healing you for 50 plus 75% of your AD as health. And on top of that, you get a flesh stack. Now, the flesh stack is what I was talking about before with the Bloodthirster. Each stack on Flesh Eater adds 1 AD to the wielder. So whenever you bite a minion, you chomp a minion with this active, you get 1 AD from it. Pretty cool item. If you look at the cost, 1460 for a 20 AD item, it's not a very good item. It's really cost inefficient. But if you look at what the passive combined with the active gives you, you're going to be getting a lot more AD, and you're going to be getting sustained. So the reason why this is a melee-only item is because melee champions in lane, they generally have trouble sustaining or getting poked by ranged champions. If you're against a ranged matchup, you're probably going to get harassed more than you're going to harass them back. So this is where Flesh Eater becomes very useful. It's an item that heals you for about 120 health, even in the earlier levels, after every 5 attacks. So as long as you can attack, you'll be able to heal pretty consistently. Now on top of that, obviously you have the AD and the lifesteal on the item already, so you still heal regardless, whether or not you use the passive and the active. So that's a good thing. Basically, if you're a melee champion who wants to sustain a lot, wants to survive the early game and scale into the late game with more AD, a lot of AD, I should say, then this is the item for you. And like I said, it's not a very interesting item, but it's a very strong item. It's an item that I would consider over basically every other lifesteal item if you were a melee champion. Like, none of these really help you. None of these items are cheap enough to help you early on when you actually need the lifesteal, the sustain. And none of these items give you like the actual stats that you want, and they're either like late game items already on their own, or they're just mediocre items. And this is an item that starts off mediocre, but can become a powerful late game item if you allow it to. So, Flesh Eater, cool item. Next item is the Mirage Blade. The Mirage Blade is a really unique item, actually. It gives you three stats. It gives you stats that are very unique. No other item in the game has this. So the Mirage Blade, it costs 3.2k, gives you 60 AD, 15% crit, 12% lifesteal. Pretty nice stats. The AD is a bit low, I guess. AD is a little bit low, but because you have these kind of unique stats, you can probably let it slide. And on top of that, there's also the passive and the active. Basic attacks apply a sand mark on the target and reveals them for 3 seconds. Only one target can be marked at one time. This passive is actually similar to an item called Lightbringer. I don't know if Lightbringer is in the game. I don't really play Twisted Tree Line, and I don't play Dominion. That was an item that used to be on those game modes, and it was an item that dealt bonus damage after a couple hits, and every auto attack would reveal the enemy for a couple seconds. So it was a pretty strong item. As long as you have this item, as long as you can hit enemies, they won't be able to juke you. If they try and juke you through a bush, too bad. You can still see them. And that's why the item is pretty strong. Now, that's not even the strong part of it, the strongest part of it. The active, Mirage Step. This item allows you to teleport 350 units directly away from the sandmark target. So here we have one of those unique effects that I was talking about that a lot of the black market items have. This is an item that is very, very useful for AD carries. Champions like fighters, assassins, and tanks who like to jump on the AD carries, this is the item that gives you basically a free flash. If you mark the enemy with an auto attack and you use this item, you blink directly away from them for slightly less than a flash. Flash is 400 range, this is 350 range, so it's a little bit less than flash, but it's a flash that's tied to your item with a 60 second cooldown. So it's a pretty low cooldown for something like this. This means that champions who only have one gap closer or no gap closers are going to have a really hard time kiting you just because you have this jump. On champions that already have jumps like Tristana, Vayne, these champions that are pretty mobile, and they get another one of these jumps, a blink I should say for this in this case, they're going to be quite annoying to catch. They're going to be very slippery, and you're going to have a hard time as a melee champion dealing with these champions. If you're a champion with no escape, let's say Kog'Maw or Varus, then you have an escape now. So it's a really cool item that makes the mobile champions stronger, but also gives the less mobile champions a little bit more of an option and a couple more potential choices when they itemize their build and they're dealing with like champions who like to jump on them. So there are also other effects to this ability to this item's ability that I want to talk about, and that is, if you buy it on a melee champion, you can still use it. It's not ranged only. So there are a lot of melee champions that don't like getting jumped on. So let's say Udyr is a really good example of a champion that likes to jump on you and just smack you to death. If you're playing someone like Zed or Talon, these champions don't like Udyr jumping on you and just slapping you over and over again. They don't like that. And this is an item that you could build on those assassins to get away from Udyr. You can auto attack him once, activate the Mirage Step, and you'll be blinking away from them, and you're gonna give him a hard time. This is something that is just, it's an item that I would say it's kind of unhealthy, just because it gives you that free blink. It's really bad for champions who get kited really well. It just makes it so that they get kited even better than before. So it's kind of bad in that sense, but I think it's a really unique item. So for the other half of melee champions using it, I want to talk about melee champions who can make plays with it. Champions like Lee Sin. Lee Sin's famous for the insect play that he can make. Well, with Mirage Step, you now have another blink that can potentially set up an insect. All you have to do is either ward jump, hit the enemy and blink with Mirage Step, or you can go in with Resonating Strike, walk behind the enemies, and then activate Mirage Step to blink back, and basically start up your insect. You can make the insect fly like this. But it's really difficult to do. I've tried it a couple times. It's not easy to do. It requires you to be very mechanically sound to do really well. It's something that takes practice, because it's not just a ward hop, it's not just a flash, it's a conditional blink. The ward hop, I guess the ward hop is kind of conditional too, but it's conditional with options. The options are dependent on you. You just place the ward and then you jump to it, right? Flash, you can blink in any direction. This one, it only blinks you away from your target. And that means that it has a lot less versatility, and it's a lot more harder to use. But if you can pull it off, if you can pull off a Mirage Step insect, then props to you, I guess. Props to you for executing a very mechanically intensive technique with this item. So that's the Mirage Blade. It's a pretty interesting item. Obviously, you can do more than that. You don't have to just play Lee Sin. Lee Sin doesn't really utilize these stats very well, but there are some champions who could, and you know, you can just experiment. See what champions you like to use it on. That's the point of these items. These items are really like something that you don't really see in League of Legends. So once you play this game mode, you really get to experiment with what the champions really can do. Alright, so let's get to the magical items. First one is Lost Chapter, and if you look at the items, pretty familiar, isn't it? It builds out of Fiendish Codex, Forbidden Idol. Where's the Merlinomicon? Oh, well, this is the Merlinomicon. Basically, this is the Merlinomicon. This gives a little less AP, but the amount of stats that you get doesn't really matter, because you're going to be paying less gold for it. It's a really cost-efficient item, and it's a middle-tier item, unlike Merlinomicon, which is the final item. And obviously I don't have much to talk about with this item, because there are three books that these Lost Chapters build into. So all of them, as you can see, they all give 100 AP, 100% base mana regen, and 20% CDR. That doesn't change with any of these, but they have passives and actives that are very unique. So let's go over the first one, Netherstride Grimoire. The passive portion of it makes it so that whenever you deal damage with a damaging spell, you gain 20% move speed. So basically this is like a Sivir passive, except it doesn't work with auto attacks, it works with spells. If you continuously hit the enemy, you're going to be getting a lot of move speed. So let's say you're playing Evelynn, and you buy this on Evelynn, go AP Evelynn or something, and you just run up to someone and just Q spam them. Well, you're going to be gaining that 20% move speed forever. As long as you keep on mashing Q in their face and dealing damage with it, you're going to be following them forever because of the move speed you're going to be getting. That's just one example. Ryze? Hard to think that an item like this would be very good for Ryze. Kind of scary, actually, I should say, because Ryze is that machine gun mage, and getting even more move speed to keep in range to snare you forever, stay in range to mash out his Qs at you, dealing damage. It's a scary item. Cassiopeia is another one. Cassiopeia is another champion who likes to just move around really quickly and spam spells at you. Basically, this is the item that you want to build on those kinds of champions. Champions who like to cast spells very quickly, very frequently, and champions who like to catch up to you with a lot of move speed. They need that mobility because they don't have blinks or for any other reason like that. The next one is Rite of Ruin. The unique passive is Razing. Gains charges upon moving or killing enemies, 200 charges max. And then once you have charges, attacking a structure expends 50 of them to deal 100 plus 15% of your AP as true damage. So it kind of looks like a Luden's Echo, except it works on structures. It's pretty scary. This is the item you're going to be wanting to get if you're going to be pushing a lot. So mages that like to split push a lot, you're probably gonna get this item. Just because you get a lot of stats for it. Obviously, the 100 AP and the other stats are very good, but because you're gonna be taking down towers very quickly, this is definitely an item that you want to be looking at and considering if you just want to push towers instead of playing like a PvP game. If you're a split pusher, let's say you're playing AP Kayle or something. AP Kayle is a pretty good split pusher. This is an item that you can consider an AP Kayle. Not only are you going to be killing enemies, it says enemies, not enemy champions. As far as I know, it works with everything. So if you split push, if you kill minions, you get charges. As you're moving through the lane, you get charges. And then once you reach the structure, you'll be expending your charges to deal bonus damage to it and taking down the tower very quickly. So that's a champion. This is an item that works on those kinds of champions. And as you can see so far, the first two different styles of champions. Obviously, you're not going to be getting both of them. If you do get both of them, that's fine, because the cooldown reduction isn't unique. The stats you'll be getting, pretty crazy stats. So you can be getting like multiple versions of these books. But each of them, they do something different, and they're pretty cool for certain champions. Now let's get to the third one. This is my favorite one, actually. The Pox Arcana. So the unique is Pox. Damaging spells apply a stack of Pox up to a max of 5 stacks to enemies for 10 seconds. So once you apply the Pox stacks from the passive portion of it, you can activate it and use Disease Harvest. It deals 100 magic damage plus 20 plus 5% ability power per stack of Pox to all nearby enemies affected with Pox. Kind of scary. This is kind of scary, isn't it? Not only does it deal damage, but it also restores 5% of your max mana per stack of Pox hit. Per stack of Pox on the enemies that can hit. So you're gonna be like the active says, you're harvesting their disease, and what you're harvesting is you're dealing a lot of damage and you're harvesting mana. So this is a very strong item for champions who just want to deal a lot of damage. The active kind of works like Twitch or Kalista. It has those kind of stack portions, the stack portion to it. It's closer to Twitch, I would say. His contaminate? Expunge? I can't actually remember. I think it's called contaminate now. Or is it expunge? Okay, so whatever it may be, it's the Twitch's E that deals damage based on the number of poison stacks on his passive that he deals to the enemy. And this is basically an AoE version of that. So this is something that is really good on champions with AoEs and damage over time. So champions like Anivia, champions like Swain, they're going to be champions who like to use this really well, that can use this really well. They're going to be dishing out a lot of AoE damage, spreading the disease, and then harvesting the disease, healing themselves for their max mana, as well as dealing a lot more damage. The champions that I listed, like I said, you can include Karthus in there too. These heavy mana champions that drain their mana when their ultimates are on, or in Karthus's case, his Defile. And the trade-off is they're going to be dealing a lot of damage to all enemies around them. But in most cases, you can't sustain it for a very long time. Except if you have Pox Arcana, you can. You'll be dealing damage, you'll be dealing bonus damage, applying the Pox, and then you'll be stealing back the mana that you're expending in order to spread the disease. It's pretty cool. It's a 60-second cooldown, so you can use it like all the time, basically. Every single fight, it should be up. It's a really low cooldown, and it's just gonna increase your damage output as well as your sustain because of the mana that you heal. It's max mana, remember. And these three champions that I listed, again, I'll just say it, three champions that I listed, they are very similar. You often build Tear and Rod of Ages on them, so they're gonna be getting healed even more. It's insane. This is a very interesting item. This is a very cool item. I wouldn't say it's one of the best items, but it's definitely a very strong item. All right, so the next item is Staff of Flowing Water. It costs 1635, so it's pretty cheap. Gives you a little bit of AP, a little bit of MR, and a little bit of mana regen. The passive portion is Mana Font. So obviously it's going to be the same as the Chalice passive, and the Grail passive, and the, what is it, Crucible passive. They're all going to be, they're all the same. It's mana font, so they're not going to overlap. So this is an item that you'd be getting, I would say, on champions that like to roam a lot and like AP. So supports probably could use this item. I wouldn't say they should use this item, but I think it's a weaker item for mid laners just because you don't get that raw power from it. It's a pretty good support item. So let's look at what the other portion of the passive is. Gains 30% move speed and 10 mana regen per 5 seconds while in the river. So, river, this entire section here is where this item becomes effective. So, if you're going to be roaming a lot, supports often roam a lot. And basically, if you buy this item on a support, it makes it so you can roam to the mid lane, roam to the top lane a lot quicker. It's 30% move speed. And that's a lot of move speed. I guess I could buy the item and show you while I talk about it. So, I bought the item on Bard. Let's get Magical Journey first and have a magical journey through to the river. So this item is really good on mainly support champions who like AP, but if you buy it on champions with AP ratios, it could work as well. I guess the amount of mana regen you get from it is also pretty good. So if you're just buying it for mana regen and this utility that you get right here, look at this move speed. This is some crazy move speed. Imagine if you had the Scuttlecrab speed shrine as well. So with Bard likes roaming a lot. He gets move speed from his chimes, and then once you move through here, you just run through so quickly. Just go through the map really, really quickly. It's a really cool item for supports. And like I said, it's not very good on mid laners. It's a little weak on mid laners, but it's definitely a great item if you like to roam a lot as a support champion. As for junglers, this could be a viable item for junglers as well. Just because junglers, they're often in the jungle, and the river portions are part of their jungle. So if you have an AP jungler who wants some mana regen and some MR, then this could be an item you could buy. But it's a pretty slot inefficient item. So slot efficiency is basically like if you have really expensive items in each slot, then you're making use of those slots. But for this item, it's really cheap. The stats are terrible. And I would say that after the mid game, you should probably sell this item because it's not very good in the mid game. Oh, or you can buy two. Okay, you can buy two. No, don't buy two. Yeah, this is me not used to the interface still. After all this time, still not used to the interface. So that's what this item is used for, the Staff of Flowing Water. It's a roaming item, it's a support item, and it could be a jungler item if you want to gank faster. It could be. Not saying it is. But the option is there, and that's basically what a lot of these things are. The option for you is there to like, cater to a certain playstyle or create a certain playstyle for yourself. All right, now we're gonna talk about my favorite item in this game mode. This is such a cool item. Whenever I talk about this item, it's like it just makes me super happy because this item is in the game. All right, so Trickster's Glass. Trickster's Glass costs 2115, gives you AP, gives you health, and it has the Eyes of Pain passive, which is the Haunting Guise and Liandry's passive. And it also has Disguise. So what Disguise does is teleports to an ally, takes on their appearance for 30 seconds, casting a spell or attacking breaks the deception. I can't use it because I'm in a custom game, but this is the range. So it's a little bit more than Flash, as you can see. Flash is 400 range, and this is probably like 500 range, 500, 550 range. Okay, maybe 475 range. Yeah, Bard's auto attack range is 500, so this is like 475 range. All right, so it's 475 range or so. And when you cast it, you blink to an enemy, and if you're familiar with Shaco, when Shaco uses his ultimate, he creates a clone of himself. This is what happens. You blink to the enemy. I believe you disappear for a second, so you can make plays with that. I'm not sure entirely if you do disappear, though, like Shaco. But it looks like you can. And basically, what it does is it turns you into the champion that you blink to. And once you do that, you can make some really crazy plays. Let's say you're the AD carry. Okay, the AD carry probably wouldn't buy this. But let's say you're a tank then. Fine. You're a tank, and you transform into the AD carry, and you run out of position. Let's say your team is here, the enemy team is around this area, and let's say you're playing Maokai, and you transform into Vayne. Everyone knows that Vayne players are really dumb, so Vayne goes to face check this brush. The enemy is waiting for her there. The enemy jumps on her. All of a sudden, Vayne transforms into Maokai. Initiation starts, and they get screwed over. That's one of the uses for this item. This item is just so cool because of the stuff you can do with it. That's just one of the things. Okay, another thing you can do with this item. Let's say you're a mid laner, let's say you're playing Lux. Sure, let's go with Lux. Lux is pretty terrible at close range, and basically she's a pretty squishy champion if anyone gets to jump on her. Well, if you transform into Maokai using this item, they're probably not going to jump on you. They're going to see, oh, it's Maokai. We're not going to be focusing Maokai. Even if he's in the front, we're not going to be focusing Maokai because chances are you're not going to kill him fast enough. The enemy team will probably kill you before you focus on the Maokai. So this can be used to discourage people from attacking squishies. And obviously, I lost an inhibitor, didn't I? I did lose an inhibitor. So obviously, once that happens, it's basically used for creating deceptive plays, and this is just one of the many plays you can do with the item. It's a really cool item. It's a really unique item that lets you make a lot of plays through the disguise, but the disguise portion is not the only portion of the item that's really nice. It's not only can you disguise yourself as enemies, but you gotta remember that there's a blink attached to it. And the blink that's attached to it is what makes it really powerful. All right, there's no super minions in this game mode. It's just giant minions. Okay, so what I've been doing with this item is I've been playing support and buying this because you get a lot of AP, you get a lot of health on it, and as a support, these are stats that you really like. So let's say I'm playing a Blitzcrank. If I'm playing Blitzcrank, then and I have trouble getting into range to pull off my hook. Well, if my Maokai is in front, I can blink onto the Maokai, transform into him, and then activate my abilities to get in range to hook someone. Basically, I'm gaining a gap closer as a support champion, and what this does is it allows me to initiate better. Not only are you going to have items like Talisman of Ascension and Righteous Glory, but you're going to have items like the Trickster's Glass that allows you to disguise yourself, blink, and create plays. You can create plays not only just by using the active portion to transform, but to blink around. And also, obviously, if you can blink in, you can also blink out, right? Because you can blink out, you can use this as an escape. It's a new escape for you. Think of it as kind of like a Lee Sin jump. If you just use this on top of your ally, then you're gonna blink on top of your ally and potentially get away from a gank. It's a really useful item. It has so many different uses, not just because it has magic pen, because it has health, it has good stats. But it also has one of the coolest actives in the game. By far. By far one of the coolest actives in the game. And this is an item that I would probably buy on any champion with AP ratios, honestly, just because it's so much fun to use. It's a really fun item. And well, that's basically it, I guess, for the Trickster's Glass. If you play this game mode, this is definitely something you should be considering as one of your items. It may not be the strongest AP item, but it's probably the most fun item in the game. So I'm actually going to stop this part, and I'm going to start a new section, just because two inhibs are down, and that's not good, because we still have a little bit more to go. We have defense and utility to go, so I'm just going to stop this for now, and well, for you guys, it'll just be in a few seconds. You'll see. All right, so we're finally back in game for the final part of the item section, and you may have noticed that some things are a little bit different on your screen, even though it's only been a few seconds for you. It's been a lot longer in real world time. That's the magic of videos, right? Alright, so we were on the final part of the black market section, talking about the defense and utility. There's also teleport boots, which I was going to get into at the very end. And this is just a reminder, I guess. I can actually see it now, and this is pretty exciting too. So let's talk about the defense items first of all. Dead Man's Plate. Dead Man's Plate gives you 600 health, 55 armor, and builds out of the most typical defensive items for armor and health, the Chain Vest and the Giant's Belt. And what Dead Man's Plate does is it gives you the passive Dreadnought. While moving, it builds stacks of momentum, increasing movement speed by up to 60 at 100 stacks. Momentum quickly decays while under the effects of stun, taunt, fear, blah 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 CC effects, and slowly decays while slowed. So hard CC decays rapidly, soft CC slows, decays slowly. And the other part of this item is Crushing Blow. It's another unique passive, and what it does is your basic attacks discharge all momentum, dealing one physical damage per two stacks, and if there are 100 stacks when it's fully stacked, then the damage is doubled, and the target is slowed by 75% for 1 second, decaying slowly, on melee champions only, though. So I think, out of all of the items that we've gone over so far, this is probably the worst item in the game. I just don't feel like this item, and it could just be me, it could just be me not really understanding how this works in a build, but I honestly don't think that this is a very good item. Statistically, yes. Statistically, this item is really strong. With the recent nerfs to Righteous Glory, in general, you don't get this much health anymore from items. 500 is like kind of the baseline. You do have some other items that are a bit stronger for health on the upper side, the upper ends of it, like Frozen Mallet, Warmogs. These give a lot more health, but normally you have something like Sunfire Cape, Righteous Glory, 450, 500, 400, 450. So this is actually a very strong, Dead Man's Plate is actually a very strong item in terms of the stats. It's just the momentum feature on it is kind of weird. Even though 60 movement speed is really nice, it seems like it's not very easy to maintain it. So the moment you enter combat, this item basically becomes worthless. So that means you're going to be buying this item on champions who like to roam a lot, on champions who basically they thrive outside of battle. Champions in the jungle maybe, maybe supports, maybe some top laners. They're able to utilize the whole momentum stacking feature on this item, and when they reach another lane, when they're about to fight, when they're about to engage, they can discharge all of their momentum stacks to use the Crushing Blow effect. And obviously, since it's melee only, you can only use it on melee champions, so this is something that maybe Nautilus could use really well. Nautilus is a champion who really likes health, likes tanky stats, and he's melee, so it could be something that you get on him. If not for the amazing stats, then maybe even for the passive. Maybe the passive is decently good on him as well, because it just gives him into the CC. But aside from that, I don't see this item being that great compared to the other items, especially in terms of the mechanics. As you saw from the previous sections, a lot of these items had really cool mechanics. This one is, to me at least, is kind of dull compared to the other ones. I don't think at this point, I don't think they're going to be changing it at any point at all, because this is like the final build of this patch. And I think we'll be getting this version on live, so this will probably be one of the least popular items. But I'll talk about that in a little bit, actually, in terms of like the whole item popularity thing, because it is important to talk about that. So that's Dead Man's Plate. It seems like there's a second portion of it. These are kind of like pauldron type things that you place on your shoulders, really bulky things. At least if this were a game where you could actually see gear, this would be like the left arm, this would be the right arm. And this one is Martyr's Gambit. Martyr's Gambit gives you 400 health, some health regen, and cooldown reduction. And what it does is, when you activate it, it binds yourself to a target champion for the next 3 seconds, redirecting 60% of all damage dealt to them to yourself. So I'm assuming this is to allies only, otherwise it'd be kind of weird. Basically, this item gives you a good amount of stats, 400 health, a bunch of regen, and 10% cooldown reduction is worth quite a bit of gold, I would say. The items that build out of it, pretty simple items. The upgrade cost is really cheap, and you basically have a powerful item. It's almost as strong as the Dead Man's Plate if you just remove the armor. I would actually value this more because it's only 100 health less, and it gives you the cooldown reduction that most champions really like. Plus, the active, it's actually a really unique passive, a really unique active, really unique ability that you can use. So let's say, well, we're gonna go with Nautilus again. I guess recently I've had this fascination with Nautilus in like every single lane. He's just really cool. So if you build this on Nautilus and you activate the active, which for some reason has no name, that's kind of dumb because a lot of these actives that are actually named. So I hope they actually add a name to this. Whatever the name is, maybe something martyr something related. You can, as Nautilus, let's say you're playing support Nautilus, you're still pretty tanky even though you're support. You bind yourself to your AD carry, and in a team fight, for the first 3 seconds, 4 3 seconds, I should say, 60% of the damage dealt to the AD carry is redirected to you. So even if they focus a priority target like the AD carry, or even the mid laner, if they're trying to focus a priority target, well, too bad, because that damage is now redirected to the tanky Nautilus, who has a ton of health and a ton of resists. I'm not sure how this is calculated exactly. I've only used it once, and I couldn't really, I didn't really see if I was taking a lot more damage than, or a lot less damage than the AD carry. But I'm assuming it works in a way where the damage redirected is applied before resists. So if you have the resists to mitigate the damage, then you take less damage than your AD carry would. Basically, this is like a, it's like a supportive tank item that you can build. You can protect your AD carry, protect your mid laner, protect whatever squishy champion you have on your team by redirecting damage from them to you, kind of like sacrificing your own health and your own well-being so that your damage dealers can be better, can be stronger, and can survive longer and continue to dish out DPS. And this is why I think this is probably one of the coolest items. We talked about Trickster's Glass extensively, and I think I went over Mirage Blade a little bit more than the other items. Really cool items, really unique mechanics, but this is something like along the same lines as those items. This is something that is just really cool for its category, for the defense category. There's only two defense items, and I think that this one really shines. This is a really cool item that most tanks, I would say, would want to build as a mid-tier item. It's a cheap item. It's only 1850, so you're not going to be using this at the very end of the game unless you have a champion who's going to be tanky regardless. Maybe a champion like a Mundo. Maybe a champion like Sion. These champions are super bulky, super tanky. They have a lot of health or health regen, and they like these stats. These are good stats for them. So maybe they can continue using this item in the late game to shield, or not really shield, I guess, redirect damage to themselves from a priority target and make their carry roles, the carry champions, a little bit better. So Marta's Gambit, definitely an item that I would consider on almost any tank, even though it's a little slot inefficient just because of the stats. The stats are not like super good for the late game. You probably want something better, something with like 500 health, cooldown reduction, or just a little more to it than this. But I think that the unique active more than makes up for any loss of stats that this item could be giving you for that slot. And now we get to the final section, utility. These three items are basically the same. So, well, there's only two items here as well. If you think of it that way, there's only two items here. And let's start with this one, Puppeteer. Puppeteer gives you 250 health, 25 magic resist, a little bit of mana regen, and 20% cooldown reduction. So those are pretty good stats. The raw stats on this item are pretty nice. They're definitely stats that most tanks or supports could use and probably like a lot. Just the cooldown reduction is just really good, and having health is always really good as well. The unique passive is Mana Font. That's because it builds out of Chalice, just like the Staff of Flowing Water, just like Mikhail's Crucible, Athene's and Holy Grail. This is a Chalice item, so it gives you a lot of mana regen. And the next portion is actually not the Chalice one, obviously. Basic attacks mark champions with a string for 6 seconds. Moving further than 1,000 range away from marked champions will break the string. So it's like a tether effect. When you hit the champion, it creates this tether. And the active portion makes use of this tether by pulling all champions marked by Puppeteer within 1,000 range towards you. The units move a maximum of 250 distance and has a 45 second cooldown. So think of this as Diana's E, or even like Orianna's ultimate, except it's attached to the champion and based on the tethers that you create with your champion. So let's say you put it on a champion like Thresh. Thresh is ranged, he can get off auto attacks really easily. So the auto attacks will create the marks, and then if he pulls champions towards him, he can use his flay, he can use his box to create this kind of prison for them. So there's a lot of synergy there. He can even pull them while he's mid-death sentence. So let's say that you're hooking onto a target and you want to drag yourself to that target. Then while you're dragging, you can pull enemies with you a little bit. It's only 250 range. It's about a fourth of the range of death sentence. So you can pull them just a little bit, but the pull is usually enough to create like a chaotic situation. And this is what the item basically is. It's an item that creates chaos by knocking around the enemies. Normally you would want to auto attack as many targets as possible and then use the active. Basically, this is a peeling tool. This is a very, very strong peeling tool, as long as you can get the auto attacks off and as long as the cooldown is up. And the cooldown is pretty low, it's 45 seconds. So like I said, utility item, supports really like it, not just because of the stats, but because you can peel for your AD carry this way. If you yourself, it's kind of mediocre, let's say you're playing a support that's not that great at peeling, maybe you're playing, like, let's say, Bard. Bard's Q is conditional. If it doesn't hit a wall or a secondary target after the first, it just slows. Obviously, your auto attacks, they'll slow eventually, so he can be pretty disruptive, but he doesn't have the same degree of peel as someone like a Janna or someone like a Thresh. So Puppeteer is a really cool item for Bard. He has 500 range, 500, yeah, 500 range. So when he auto attacks things and applies his meeps, he also applies the Puppeteer strings. So it's there's this little, it works really well with Bard there. And because of that, he's a pretty good champion to give this additional peel. Like I mentioned before with the previous items, it's not just about how the item synergizes with the champion itself, but what kind of synergy you can create or even make up for, like a lack of synergy that they might have, a lack of utility they may have. Well, these items, a lot of these items give you something new. They give you a new effect. Like these items, especially these two, this one, and then this one, you just have these unique effects that you never, that have never been seen in previous items in the game. And now that they're in the game, now that you have these items, and now that you can buy these items in this game mode, you have the option of basically creating a champion's identity not based on their abilities, really. You can base their identity on their items as well. But of course, since items are available to everyone, then obviously it's not just something exclusive. But there are definitely champions who can use items, certain items, better. If you, let's say if you buy Marta's Gambit on Bard, it's not going to be as good as if you bought Marta's Gambit on Nautilus. If you buy Puppeteer on someone like Nami, like, normally you probably don't want to pull people into you. Obviously, you can still peel with it, but it's not like as good as if you had someone who had good utility to make up for like bringing a target closer to you. So that's Puppeteer. It's another item that you can use to create chaos, and it's another item with unique effects. Now let's get to the second utility item. And this is an interesting item. This is a very cool item that I feel brings a new dynamic to the game. So first of all, let's talk about the first one, Merc Sphere. Now before we get into Merc Sphere, I do want to compare it with this. Take a look at the gold value, 365, 365. So you may have guessed it, this is a gold generation item. And unlike the other gold generation items, you're not limited to one of them. So this is like a secondary gold generation item for you, on top of your already gold generation item. And it's not just restricted to supports. You can buy it on anyone you want, but the stats are really mediocre, so you probably will just put it on a support anyway. But you don't buy it for the stats. You buy it because you want the active. Starting with the first one, shields an ally for 60 health and generates gold based on the damage they take. 25% of the damage absorbed, and it has a 15-second cooldown. So whenever you shield an ally, you gain up to 15 gold. That's what it is. This one gives you up to 15 gold every time you use it. Once the 15 gold is obtained, that means that the shield is already broken because it's 25% of 60, then you can't generate any more gold. And you can't generate gold on self-shields against monsters as well. So you can't just buy this as a jungle item. You can't just buy this as a jungle item, cast it on yourself every 15 seconds, and make 15 gold every 15 seconds. Because that'd be kind of ridiculous. 15 gold per 15 seconds is quite a lot. But you can still use this in lane. You can still use this as a support. So you'll be generating gold by creating a shield for your ally. It's best used, I would say, for support, just because the stats are kind of mediocre for other champion roles. But the good thing is that it's not just this. You can upgrade it to different items. And as you upgrade it, the stats do improve a little bit. It does become a better item overall, not just because the shield increases, but because you get decent stats. 20% cooldown reduction and some mana regen is pretty good. And, well, let's actually talk about the third one. The second one, the shield, just increases a little bit. You gain up to 25 gold instead of 15 gold, so 10 more gold. This is the crazy one. This is the really, really crazy one. Lobs a bubble that shields nearby allies for 150 health and generates gold equal to 25% of the damage absorbed, maximum of 100 gold per cast. So every 15 seconds, you can get yourself 100 gold. I don't know of any item in the game that's remotely close to making that much gold. So if you really, really did want gold, then you could probably buy this item and try and make use of that. It's a really big investment because it is 2.1k gold just to get it. But if you really like making gold, if you're going for the long game, then this is a possible item. But again, it's generally a support item. And lobbing the shield, the shield effect is what makes it a really good support item. When you stay in the back line, let's actually buy this item. This is the range of the shield. And this is what it looks like. So it kind of looks like a quirky Q, except like bard style quirky Q. So you toss out the shield, and anyone in the area gets a shield, and you get gold whenever they take damage. So basically, if you stay at a distance in a poke war, I think I mentioned earlier that in this game mode, poking is going to be very, very strong because you're going to be pushing the lanes back and forth. You're going to want to push the lanes back and forth. So if you have a shield to go along with it, it can actually help you a lot. If you're stuck in a stalemate, let's say mid, stalemate mid, both sides pushing back and forth, then the shield is actually really good. You can block some damage for your team, and you can get some gold for yourself as well. So not only are you helping out your team by keeping them healthy, but you're also helping yourself by giving yourself more gold and making sure that you can scale into the late game and just be better overall. So this is what the shield looks like. It's kind of like a golden orb. And it lasts for a pretty long period of time, as you can see. So that's Swindler's Orb. That's the second utility item. There's really not much else to say about it other than like it's a shielding item, it's a gold generation item, and it's a pretty cool item overall, except the stats are shitty. I keep reiterating that, but I can't really emphasize that enough. The stats are really horrible. If you're just buying for the base stats, it's just not a good item. So we've gone over defense, we've gone over utility. Let's go over the final one. The final new item in this game mode. I'm not gonna buy this one because I can't afford it, but I'll show you once I get enough gold. Actually, I'll just sell this. All right, let's buy Berserker's Greaves just because why the hell not? Okay, so it's on a 1 minute cooldown. Berserker's Greave teleport. So the teleport enchant on boots, it gives you a 4 minute cooldown teleport. And it's a 60 second cooldown on purchase, as you can see. So a 1 minute cooldown. Basically, this is exactly the same as Summoner Teleport, except it's a 1 minute less cooldown. Summoner Teleport is a 5 minute cooldown. If you teleport to a tower, it's less. If you cancel it, it's less. But like in general, like it's a 5 minute cooldown. Like, think of it as a 5 minute cooldown. This one is a 4 minute cooldown, so it's a minute shorter. If you run like Shen with teleport and teleport boots, then he has three teleports, so that potential is there. The potential objective game, objective focus game is there, especially in a game mode where you have the brawlers. The brawlers are there to create this kind of objective and tactical play where you make the right decisions, and your decisions basically reflect your style of like your team's style, the way you want to approach the game. Do you want to siege a lot? Do you want to poke champions a lot? Do you want to counter their siege? Do you want utility? Do you want to just be annoying? These are what these brawlers do. And depending on which style you want to play, maybe you want to get teleport boots. The other boots enchants, the boot enchantments, they're still good. People still buy Alacrity on almost everything. They still buy Home Guard on almost everything. Captain Boots is really good on tanks and supports. Fur is not that great. Most people don't get this item. And distortion is obviously good if you have flash teleport. But teleport itself is also really good. Teleport gives you potential map pressure. You can pressure one side of the map, teleport to the other. You can, let's say, you're gonna have a dragon fight, you're gonna have a baron fight, some kind of objective fight, some kind of gank or counter gank. You can be there no matter what your role is. Can be a mid laner with Flash Ignite Teleport if you get the teleport boots. You can be a support with Flash Ignite slash Exhaust and Teleport. You can be around the map. So it's actually really cool that they added this. In Earth mode, if you remember in Earth mode, most people ran Flash and Teleport. Well, imagine if this item was in Earth mode. You would have a really low cooldown teleport. Along with other summoners, you'd have three summoner spells, and this is a really interesting aspect that I'll go into shortly about game diversity in general and summoner spell diversity. So, like, there's not much really I can add to this other than it gives you a teleport. I guess I'll show you what it looks like. I'll teleport to this minion wave because it's a huge wave pushing the tower. It's basically teleport. It's exactly what it is. You teleport to a minion. It makes it so it doesn't take damage, becomes invulnerable, and then you can pressure the tower and take the towers like this. So that's basically what the teleport enchant is, and there's really not much to it. The more important thing to look at is like what it actually means for the game overall, and just in general what all of these items, what these minions, I clicked over here. It's supposed to be over here. What the black market items, what the brawlers do for the actual game itself, how we look at the game, and the potential future of League of Legends is the most important thing I want to talk about. So I'm gonna cut this section, and I'm gonna get into the analysis of the future of League of Legends when considering all of the stuff that we have seen in this game mode. I'm gonna buy a rat before. Oh, I can't buy him. I'm not in the shop. I'm dumb. Okay, I'm just gonna cut the video here. Cut! All right, so I kept talking about potential this, potential that, especially when considering mechanics, but the main point I was trying to make was the fact that all these things now exist in League of Legends, albeit, yeah, it's in this featured game mode, so it's kind of a limited usage, limited time kind of thing. It just means that the potential could be there. These items, this style of play, it could potentially make its way into Summoner's Rift in the future. Items like Mirage Blade, Martyr's Gambit, Trickster's Glass, Puppeteer, those four items are especially cool. And, well, if they made their way to Summoner's Rift, wouldn't that be really cool? I would think so. One of the newest items that has been added into the game on PvE recently was Zeke's Harbinger, the reworked version of Zeke's Herald. That item's already displaying new mechanics with the whole conduit and charge feature. This means that Riot is open to adding new mechanics to the game for the sake of diversity. AP itemization, that has been reworked recently as well. It's been changed altogether. I would argue that it's still not really in the best spot. Basically, because the numbers on the items were normalized, the weaker items were balanced to be more in line with the higher end items. Some of them potentially even better now, but we didn't really need this kind of rework in the game because I'd rather have something like the Arcana items in the black market, the items that gave effects with more interactivity, or that you could get potentially to accentuate a champion's strength more, or to compensate for a champion's weakness. That's what I would have wanted to see in this AP itemization change that we've gotten recently. But did we really need that kind of rework? I liked it. I thought it was good. I thought it added more diversity to the game, but they could have done better. I'd rather have items that could be bought reactively to the enemy's team composition. This lets you make more intelligent team-based decisions. Or maybe even have items or item enchantments that give you bonus effects. Maybe you could have an item enchantment like Liandry's Burn effect, put it on a death cap or something. That'd be pretty broken, actually. The potential is there. Why not have this kind of diversity? Is the unique passive feature really the way you want to go with the game? That's the kind of question I would ask Riot. Right now, AD carry itemization has been really stale. It has been for a very long time, actually. You basically have these four power items on most AD carries. You build an Infinity Edge, Phantom Dancer, Bloodthirster, Last Whisper. It was kind of like how AP itemization was before the rework. All of these items, they're just strong in terms of numbers, and they don't really do much else. You bought them because you want the power in the items. And since auto attacks are 100% reliable, they're not skill shots or anything like that, once you have those numbers, those massive power numbers, basically there's nothing more to it. There's no outplay potential, there's no catch-up potential from behind. And it doesn't feel good if you aren't in the position that where you have more power than the enemy team. If Riot made items that focus more on unique effects, potential outplay effects, I think that'd be pretty interesting. Items like Mirage Blade, that's a pretty good example. The Mirage Step active, once you hit an enemy, it marks them, and then when you activate it, you blink away from them. That's really cool. These are cool effects that I think items in League of Legends should have. Tank items. Okay, let's talk about tanks for a bit then. Tanks have gotten a lot of love recently. Early in the year, there was the Cinderhulk jungle enchantment. Righteous Glory was added into the game and buffed to be really powerful, recently nerfed. Champions like Olaf, they really like Righteous Glory because they kind of have mediocre ways to close a gap. Spirit Visage, more recently, has been updated so that it not only gives you bonus effects from self-healing and regeneration, it's also from other champions. Like if you have a Soraka on your team, then the Soraka's heals will be more effective on you. So you added more team-based synergy. These items are not just I'm gonna buy raw stats. I'm gonna have stats that are affected by my team as well. So more interesting decisions to be made there. So on the topic of tank items, Martyr's Gambit, the item that redirects damage from an ally champion to yourself, that's a really cool mechanic. That's a really cool item. Instead of having this really set in stone style of play, in League of Legends you have like a frontline, backline, midline kind of thing. Tanks are in the frontline soaking up damage and just disabling enemies, pushing up their frontline, pushing up your team's frontline, backing off from the frontline, whatever. Like this kind of tug of war kind of gameplay style. That's what League of Legends is right now. But what if you had something like Martyr's Gambit, where you could have a frontline AD carry? We've seen these Protect the AD carry comps, the Juggernaut comps, mid top lane, mid or top Lulu, Orianna mid maybe, and just these tons of shields and shields and shields on the front line Kog'Maw that just deals a ton of damage. You could have that kind of playstyle with other AD carries now if you had an item like Martyr's Gambit. So, team composition-wise, more diversity there as well. It's just another option for you, for your team to protect the AD carry, except instead of just shielding them and reducing the damage they take, you're redirecting the damage they take to yourself. So there's a new kind of mechanic that creates this new kind of composition style that is potentially there for you to use. These are the options that what makes all these items so great. I think that Riot is looking outside the box to create new player experiences. I think that these new items, this new game mode, all of these new mechanics, it's a step in the right direction for League of Legends. The game itself has become increasingly complex and diverse since it was first released. For people who have been playing since beta or before season one, during the kind of like preseason, there was a preseason period. That's when I started playing, a little bit after the beta during the preseason. We saw really bland champions, champions like Soraka back then. What did Soraka do? If you were near her, you got magic resist. That was Soraka's passive. It's not very exciting, right? She point and click heals you or heals your mana. It's pretty boring, right? I guess you could argue that Soraka in her current state right now is still pretty dumb. She's a pretty toxic champion, but her kit is much more up to date. There's much more interactivity to it. There's much more risk versus reward to it instead of just having this one style. Team compositions in general, with more champions, with more styles of champions, with more items, with having risk versus reward on certain types of champions. Champion diversity and mechanics. This is evidence of the game becoming more complex and diverse. Now, with the items that you see in Black Market Brawlers, you see more item diversity, you see more mechanics diversity. That's what they're looking at the moment. I guess I would say that around season two, season three, behind the scenes is when Riot was looking at really unique mechanics like Azir. Azir was first hinted at around season two, season three, but we didn't see him until late season four. So it takes quite a long time for Riot to actually create something that's concrete, something that you will put in place. Kalista is another example. Kalista, crazy mechanics. Bard, Tahm Kench, these are some of the most recent champions that have had crazy, crazy mechanics added. Now it's item time. These are the items that Riot is potentially looking at to add to the game. These potential new effects and just a new style of item in general that could be in the game in the future. Finally, on the topic of teleport enchant boots, summoner spells have been a problematic thing for a long time. Flash is being taken 99% of the time, and teleport is taken most of the time on top lane. The other summoners that are actively considered, you have like stuff like Ignite, Exhaust, Heal, and obviously Smite is taken in the jungle and sometimes in the lanes. Basically, that leaves a couple summoner spells that are never used or rarely used, except in a very few scenarios. By adding a summoner spell to the game in item form, that basically opens up more diversity in pre-game choices. Right now, the pre-game choices you have, it's like runes, masteries, champions, picks and bans, and summoner spells being kind of an afterthought, most of the time anyway. You just take Flash and then you take something else, that's it. Shifting more consideration into summoner spells in the pre-game, it opens up a huge possibility for different things in the game. I think that it goes without saying that at some point Riot will be considering a rework of summoner spells, especially ones like Clarity and Clairvoyance. And I think that boots enchantments, it's one of the potential paths they can take. This is why we're seeing teleport boots. If it does end up going this way, the game could be turned upside down, especially if they consider something crazy, like, let's say, removing Flash from the game, removing teleport from the game, and turning them into items. Who knows what could happen in season 6 and 7? Now, on top of all the itemization changes, there's also the brawlers. Minions are one of the most important factors in League of Legends, and changing them could change the landscape of the game far more than anything else. The reason for this is, regardless of everything in the game, champion, runes, masteries, whatever, all that kind of stuff, items even, minions are the only constant in the game. That and structures, I guess. These things are on the map. These are map-based I guess you could call them objects, constants. Constants is a better word to use, so I'll just continue using the word constant. These are the constants of the game, and if players were given the option to diversify their minion choices from the enemy team's minion choices, creating minions that play towards your strengths and the enemy's weaknesses, it would add a significant amount of strategic depth to the game, even to the point where the game would potentially lose a lot of players because of it. That's how important minions are to the game as a constant. That's how different the game would be if you could actively control your minions, change your minions to perform different tasks. Why stop at minions? Why not have tower diversity? Different types of bases even? Who knows? These are all things that may be considered in the future as potential changes that could diversify, that could add diversity in the game. With all this being said, Black Market Brawlers, if you haven't guessed it already, is the testing ground for the future of League of Legends. If you look at the previous featured game modes, we've had nothing like this before. Nothing has been like this before, and this is why I was so excited to play this. I played it a lot more than I thought I would. I played it a lot more than almost every game mode. I guess the only exception would be Earth, because everyone liked playing Earth. I didn't particularly like it, but no one else wanted to play other types of game modes at that point, so I was stuck with playing Earth for a very long time. The point is that right now, Black Market Brawlers is potentially going to be the future of League of Legends. It's so different from the other featured game modes, and I'm pretty sure that the data that Riot will be getting from this is going to be put to good use. They're going to see patterns in the data that they get. So like certain items will be better, certain items are popular. Basically, the criticisms and the acclaim that we give them for this game mode is going to help shape the future of League of Legends. So we are living in the potential future of League of Legends at the moment. This is kind of like a breaking point for us as players of the game, and it's very exciting to think of it that way. I'm really, really excited to think of how this will affect the future of League of Legends. Like, there's just so much to this game mode that's strategically interesting compared to the other featured game modes. And I think that strategy is something that players, whether they consciously or subconsciously realize, they like in the game. They like strategy in the game. They like making decisions in the game, adding new itemization changes, adding minion changes that you can make decisions on. That's really cool. So when this game mode hits live, be sure to give it a try. And keep your mind open when you're playing it. It's not Summoner's Rift. It's something new altogether. It's something chaotic and fresh. So I hope you have as much fun with it as I had with it. I guess with that being said, that's it for this video. And I hope you enjoyed it. All the segments and whatnot, all the fails, like trying to buy a brawler while not being at base. And kind of a look into not just a new game mode, but a potential future for League of Legends itself. So, thanks for watching, everyone. Goodbye.